Can you hear us, David?
The sound went off for a bit.
This microphone is better, I think.
Yes.
We can start, we are ready. Alexander, you can start.
Okay. So first of all, I thank the organizers of this meeting for inviting my talk. Currently, it's difficult to travel from Ukraine. So, of course, my congratulations and happy birthday to Felix. And I start my talk. It's called Hagerup property and Kasdan pairs in terms of ergodic infinite measure preserving actions. I start with definition of the Hagerup property. So let G be a non-compact, locally compact second countable group. Then it has Hagerup property or Gromov's IT minimum if there is a weakly continuous unitary representation V of G in a separable Hilbert space, such that V goes to zero in the weak operator topology as G goes to infinity, that is leaving every compact. And there is one more property, which is called existence of almost invariant vectors. What does it mean? For every epsilon and every compact subset K in the group, there is a unit vector from the Hilbert space such that this property is satisfied. The vector is up to epsilon invariant under operator VG when G runs K. Examples. All amenable groups has the Hagerup property. It's easy to see considering the left regular representation. Then left regular representation, of course, possess the property of tending to zero in the weak operator topology. And as for this specific almost invariant vector, just consider a sequence of characteristic sets of a Fellner. They take a Fellner sequence, and this is a sequence of subsets, and then consider of characteristic functions, indicators of these sets, and then you get, how to say, if you take one element of the sequence, then it has this property. Okay. Next, there are also non-amenable groups which have the Hagerup property. For instance, SON1, SUN1, when n greater than 2, the free groups, the Coxeter groups, that's a kind of groups generated by involutions with some specific relations between them, some cat groups, some groups acting on trees, and so on, so on. So many groups from different branches of mathematics. Another very important property of Hagerup groups is that for them, and the famous Baum-Kohn conjecture holds. So it's quite difficult to explain what is this. It's related to K theory, but it's famous, and that's why Hagerup groups with Hagerup property are popular in math. Let me also say that the class of discrete countable Hagerup groups is closed under free products and res products. There is a book with the five authors written in published in 2001, dedicated completely to groups with the Hagerup property. So from time to time, I will refer to this book and call it the book. There is a dynamical characterization of the Hagerup property. It's classical in the finite in the framework of finite measure preserving actions. To give this a characterization, let me give some definitions. First of all, the definition of mixing. So suppose that G acts on a standard probability space Z. And K is a probability invariant measure on the space. The action is S. S is called mixing if this property is satisfied. Next definition, a sequence of Borel subsets AN of strictly positive measure is called S asymptotically invariant if for each compact subset K, we have this property. Okay, and there is a definition of a strong ergodicity. S is strong ergodic if each S asymptotically invariant sequence AN is trivial. That is, this limit is zero. So now I'm ready to give this classical dynamical characterization of Hagerup. G is Hagerup if and only if there is a mixing non-strongly ergodic probability preserving free G action. And then the proof can be found, for instance, in the book by five authors. Okay, so two properties of this action. Mixing and non-strongly ergodic, which means that there is an asymptotically invariant sequence for this action. Okay, and recently it appeared that it's possible to give another characterization of Hagerup property in terms of infinite measure preserving actions. To give this characterization, I need more definitions. So let G be as above, and let S be a free measure preserving G action on sigma finite, generally infinite sigma finite standard measure space. Then we can have some dynamical effects which are absent in the finite measure preserving case. Namely, S can be totally dissipative, which means that the partition of X into S orbits is measurable. That is, there is a measurable subset of X which meets almost every S orbit exactly once. S is called conservative if there is no S invariant subset A of positive measure such that the restriction of S to A is totally dissipative. For general action, there is a unique decomposition of the space into totally dissipative and the conservative parts. These parts are invariant and disjoint, of course. S is called ergodic if each measurable S invariant sets if either of a zero measure or full measure. So the definition is exactly as in the finite measure preserving case. S is called weakly mixing if for each ergodic probability preserving G action R, the product G action is ergodic. Next definition, X is sharply weak mixing if it is ergodic conservative. And for each ergodic conservative non-singular G action R, on an anatomic probability space, the product G action SR is either what if or totally dissipative. So this is, in a sense, an infinite counterpart of mild mixing property. This says that S is of zero type if the limit, this limit, it exists and equals limit for all subsets AB of finite measure. Of course, it's a zero type is analog of mixing in infinite measure. Next, we say that AM, the sequence of subsets in the space of positive finite measure, is Fellner, S Fellner, if this property is satisfied for each compact subset K. For instance, if S is just the action of G on itself by, say, left rotations, then the definition of Fellner sequence is exactly the definition of Fellner sequence in the classical sense of the group. If, moreover, the Fellner sequence is increasing and covers the whole space, we say that AN is exhaustive. So recently, in the paper by Delaby, Jolissin, and Sam Brunel, a new characterization of Hagiru property was found in terms of infinite measure preserving actions. Namely, G has the Hagiru property if and only if there is a zero type measure preserving G action on an infinite sigma finite measure space, admitting a sequence of non-negative unit vectors such that this property holds. So you see this characterization as totally spectral. It is given in the terms of Koopman representation, unitary representation associated with T. I recall that Koopman representation is given by this natural formula, where F is an element of the Hilbert space L2, and UTG just the composition F with the action TG minus one. Since TG preserves mu, UT is unitary. About this theorem by Delaby-Jolissin, Zembrunen. Perhaps it's a nice characterization, spectral characterization, but as for a purely dynamical point of view, what we have a zero type measure preserving G action. But what does it mean, zero type? It's a very weak dynamical properties. It's an analog of mixing, but in finite measure. But mixing in finite measure is very strong. It implies ergodicity, it implies weak mixing. But in infinite measure, zero type can be non-ergodic. It can be even non-conservative. So from ergodic theory point of view, it's somehow not. Rather poor characterization if you just say that an action is of zero type but nothing more. So my purpose was to find a similar characterization, but to say more about dynamical properties of T. By dynamical properties, I mean conservativeness, ergodicity, mixing, and so on. So my first result is Theorem 1, the following characterization. G has the Hagiru property if and only if there is a sharply weak mixing, zero type, measure preserving free G action T on an infinite sigma finite standard measure space, admitting and exhausting T Fellner sequence of subsets. And there is also a similar characterization, but this time, the Fellner sequence AN has an additional property that it is normalized. So every set AN is of measure one. Okay, and let me say that the sharp weak mixing implies conservativeness, ergodicity, and weak mixing. So what is the idea, how to prove this theorem? So first step is to use the mixing non-strongly ergodic free probability preserving G action S from the book, which was constructed in this book. And in fact, they use a Gaussian construction, and it's reciprocal to the very famous construction by Cohn Weiss, characterization of property T, dynamical characterization of property T, which was published in 1980. So it's something, how to say, it was this construction uses Gaussian construction and some tricks. Okay, so I start with this finite measure preserving in G action S. On the next step, I apply the restricted infinite product construction by Moore-Hill to this finite measure preserving action S. So this construction, I think it's interesting by itself, not only in the framework of Hagerup property. And it seems to me it's a bit underestimated in ergodic theory. The paper by Hill, which in turn is based on Moore paper, was published in 1971. And as far as I know, there were no references to this paper until my work's recent. But it's rather classical, and I'm going to explain this construction. So when we apply this construction to S, and S is mixing finite measure preserving action, we obtain a sigma finite zero type action S, and which admits an S Fellner sequence. On the next step, we prove that S is IDPFT. It's a concept which recently was introduced by Mariusz Lemanczyk and me, and later I will give details. What is this? What is it? And finally, we choose the parameters of the Moore-Hill construction in such a way that S is conservative. And if S is conservative and IDPFT and plus some more properties, we immediately conclude that S is sharply weak mixing. Okay, so we proved theorem one completely. Now I would like to give more details on every of this step except the first one. So what is the restricted infinite product of probability measures? So suppose we have a standard non-atomic probability space. In fact, non-atomic, it's not important, just standard probability space. Fix a sequence B, Bn of subsets of positive measure, and consider the infinite product. Xb is yc power n. Now, let's form a sequence of subsets in X. We denote them by bn in this way. Bn is the product, direct product, yn cross bn plus one, cross bn plus two, and so on and so on. Of course, we have a nested sequence in X. And now we define a measure gamma B on X by restrictions. So first of all, we define the restriction of gamma B on Bn. The restriction is the following. So as for the first n coordinate, we take just measure gamma and cross gamma, 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 n times, and then normalize, just normalize it with gamma b1, gamma bn product. And then we multiply it on the following with the following. We restrict gamma on Bn plus one, again normalize. This is a probability space. Then again, restrict gamma to Bn2, normalize, and this is a probability space. So here the tail is an infinite direct product of probability space, so it's well defined. Okay, and then just note that if we consider gamma B restricted to Bn plus one, and then restricted to Bn, then we obtain exactly gamma B restricted to Bn. So this family of measures, I mean the restrictions, are compatible. If they're compatible, then we can define measure as an inductive limit on the whole space XB. So gamma B is a measure which is supported on the union of all these B1, B2, and so on. And the measure of Bn, we can calculate, it's easily see, is a product of gamma Bj minus one, product J runs from one to n. And of course, a gamma B is a sigma finite measure. It is infinite if and only if this infinite product is zero, of course. So gamma B is called the restricted infinite power of gamma with respect to B. Okay, so this is a definition of the restricted infinite product. So we started with a probability space and we get an infinite measure space. Now suppose we have a gamma preserving transformation in the original space. Probability in space Y. It is called T. Sorry. Consider the infinite product of T, T power n. This is the transformation on X. So we want to know whether T preserves the measure gamma B, which we have just defined. And it's easy to check that if this condition holds, if the series converges, then T preserves gamma B. Both T preserves gamma B. So we found a nice condition, which easily to check, which guarantees that the T bolt preserves gamma B. So whenever we have now a gamma preserving G action S, in our probability space. And if we assume that this condition holds for each G, then we obtain immediately an infinite measure preserving G action in the space X furnished with gamma B. And moreover, we have nice properties. If S is mixing and gamma B is infinite, then S bolt is of zero type. And if supremum of this sum of this series less than series less than infinity for each compact K, then B is an S Hilner sequence. So at this point, in fact, we have proved the main result of the paper of three authors. But we want to prove more. We want to get a sharp weak mixing. So how to achieve sharp weak mixing? For that we use the property of IDPFT, infinite direct product of finite types. So what is the definition of the section? Suppose we have and infinitely many ergodic measure preserving G actions on a standard probability space, Yn, mu n. And let mu n be just a measure, also probability equivalent to mu n. So mu n is invariant, but mu n is just equivalent to the invariant measure mu. Now, consider the infinite direct product, x mu, it's infinite direct product of mu n. So if we take mu n instead of mu n, then we'll get a space with a measure nu, which is invariant under the infinite direct product of tn. But we take the infinite direct product of mu n. Okay, and then in fact, it's possible that mu is not non-singular with respect to tg. But let's suppose that mu is non-singular with respect to tg. Then we have a non-singular dynamical system, and it is called the infinite direct product of finite types. In fact, it's easy to write when this happens, when mu composed with tg is equivalent to mu. This is done by Kakutani theorem, or the equivalent of two infinite products of infinite products of probability measures. Okay. So why this definition is interesting? Why this concept is interesting? Mainly because of the following theorem. Suppose we have an IDPFT system. So this is a non-singular system, non-singular G action. And if Tn is mixing for each n, mixing of course with respect to the invariant measure mu n, mixing on the space, on this space, Yn mu n. But then T furnished with measure mu is either totally dissipative or conservative. Moreover, if T is conservative, then it's sharply weak mixing. So conservativity already implies rather strong ergodic properties. So it's ergodic, it's weak mixing, it's even sharp weak mixing. So in order to prove that a system is sharply weak mixing, provided that the system is IDPFT, it's sufficient to prove that it is conservative. Okay, and that's what we are going to do in our situation. Let me recall what is Hellinger distance between two probability measures on Y. It is given by the following integral, square root Hellinger distance, where theta is any measure which measures alpha and beta, and the result, this integral does not depend on theta. For instance, so theta can be taken alpha plus beta divided by two. And now there is the following analog of the Kakutani theorem, which is proved by Hill. It's about equivalence of gamma b, the infinite power, infinite restricted power to the infinite direct product of probability measures. So suppose we have a sequence of probability measures on Y, and suppose that every measure mu n is equivalent to gamma. I recall that gamma is an invariant measure, original invariant measure on the space Y. So if this series converges, so what is this series? It's a square root series of square root Hellinger distances between mu n and the normalized restrictions of gamma to bn. Then gamma b is equivalent to the infinite direct product of mu. Okay, so if we know that gamma b is quasi-invariant, then of course this measure is quasi-invariant with respect to action g. And we see that it's an IDP, so we obtain that gamma b is IDPFT, equivalent to IDPFT. And in our case, gamma bn is some 0.5. So if you take epsilon n between 0.1, such that the series epsilon n converges, and what we do, we somehow concentrate our measure around Bn. So what is outside Bn is multiplied by epsilon m. So this term is very small. And this term is large. This term is large. And then consider measure which is equivalent mu n, which is equivalent to gamma, and the corresponding Radon-Nikodym derivative is phi n. Okay. Then it's possible to easily calculate the squared Hellinger distance from gamma restricted to Bn normalized and mu n. It's like that. And of course, we see that the series, this series converges. So we obtain that gamma b is really equivalent, is equivalent to an IDPFT match. Okay, so it remains to show that gamma b is conservative, because so gamma b is equivalent to the infinite product mu n, of course it is IDP, and hence it's IDPFT with mixing in every coordinate. So how to achieve conservativeness? How to prove conservativeness? For that, we should pass to a subsequence in D and construct a new system. Just change our B, original B. Well, this is a bit technical, but let me just explain in several words the idea, how to prove that our action is conservative. In fact, not our action, but our action after we modify our B. So look at the system X gamma BS. S is a direct product, and gamma B is the restricted infinite product of gamma. Now consider the space y gamma t power n as a factor of this action. Then it's of course conservative, because gamma is a probability preserving action. We know that every probability preserving action is conservative. So now consider a sequence of refining finite partitions which generate the whole sigma algebra. Take an atom of a fixed partition. And what does it mean, conservativeness? So what the conservativeness means? So this means that for every this delta, we can find a subset delta zero, which is substantial, which means it occupies a proportion, a fixed proportion, say 0.9, 0.5 of delta. And it has such properties that every point from delta zero returns to delta when g is okay, and g fn is a returning time. So in such a way we define some finite family of returning times, and then having this set fn, we can find M, a very large number, such that this infinite product is very close to one. It's more than 0.999. So why do we need this? We need some estimation for measure in for gamma B. Gamma B is an infinite product, but now we have some, how to say, some estimation for only n first coordinate. So we don't control the tail, the infinite tail. So how to control the infinite tail? We use this property, but to control, but we see that again, we can control not the whole tail, but main part of this tail starting from M. But M is a very large number, and we don't control anything between N and M. So what should we do? Just drop all these coordinates. So we have a hole between N and M. Okay, we drop these coordinates. And then we do like that with every n. So we construct a subsequence of b. Okay, every bn was of measure 1/2, then any infinite subsequence is also 1/2. And the property, look here, if the infinite product is more than 0.999, and we drop some factors here, but what does it mean we drop some factor here? Which means that we replace it with one, but every factor is less than one. So when we drop something, we get the infinite product will be larger. So after passing to a subsequence, still we will have this nice property. Okay, and so on. So look here, we start with refining partitions in delta n, and then we extend this to the whole space. Our whole space is the product of the head and the tail. And then using this property, we can conclude that our action is conservative. Our action S on this space, restricted product, is conservative. So that's what we want. Of course, it's not a proof, just some idea, sorry. Okay, and we obtain a corollary now. So theorem one is fully proved. And we can get a corollary from it. Theorem two, G has the Hagiru property, if and only if there is a mixing probability preserving Poisson G action that is not strongly ergodic. So what is new now is that we can even claim that this action, so without, if we cross out Poisson, then it's a known classical characterization. The word Poisson is new. So what does it mean? So what Poisson means? Definition of Poisson action. So suppose we have an infinite sigma finite non-atomic standard measure space. Let the X star be the set of all purely atomic sigma finite measure on X. For each subset A, define the function NA by the following formula. And let V star with the smallest sigma algebra such that all these mappings are V star measurable. Then there is a unique probability measure mu star on V star satisfying that mu star composed with NA minus one is the Poisson distribution with parameter mu A for every subset A of finite positive measure. And given countable family A1, A2, and so on of mutually disjoint subsets A1, A2, the corresponding random variables NA1, NA2, and so on are independent. And then whenever we have a new preserving G action on X, then we consider a dual action on measures. Omega is a measure. SG star acts natural way on the measure. Then S star will be a new preserving transform, mu star preserving transformation on X star. And S star will be a mu star preserving G action, which is called the Poisson suspension of S. This is a classical definition. So we get, so whenever we have infinite measure preserving action, we can consider the Poisson suspension. And we call Poisson suspension, any action which is isomorphic to a Poisson suspension is called the Poisson action. So as soon as we have something, some theorem, some statement about infinite measure preserving action, we can pass to we can apply this Poisson functor and get a dual reciprocal theorem for in terms of Poisson measure preserving probability actions. That's what is done. So theorem two just follows easily from theorem one. Okay, now the second part of my talk. So pairs, what is a pairs of groups with property T, Kazhdan property T? So definition of Kazhdan property T. Suppose we have locally compact second countable group G and a non-compact closed subgroup H in G. Then the pair HG has property T if for each unitary representation V satisfying the property which we call existence of almost invariant vector. You already encountered with this property in the beginning of my talk. So whenever there is almost invariant vector, then there is an invariant vector, a unit vector in the Hilbert space, which is invariant under VH for every H from H, from the subgroup. There is an invariant vector for the subgroup action, subgroup representation. Example of a Kazhdan pair. For instance, Z2 and the Z2 semi-direct product with SL2Z, where SL2Z acts in a natural way on Z2 as a matrix acting on vector. By the way, SL2Z itself does not have property T. Okay, and what is property T for a single group and a property T for pairs of groups? G has property T if and only if a pair G contains G has property T. Okay. And an observation, if G is Hagerup, then the pair HG never has property T. Why it is so? If G is Hagerup, then by definition, there is a zero type representation, that is a representation of G such that V of G goes weakly to zero when G goes to infinity, which has an almost invariant vector. But if it has almost invariant vector, then there is a unit vector which is invariant under VH for every H from H. But it cannot happen because the group, because the representation is of zero type. VH goes to zero, so it cannot have invariant vector except for zero vector. Okay, so theorem three. Characterization of group, a characterization of the property T in terms of infinite measure preserving actions. If a pair HG has property T, then each measure preserving G action of G on a sigma finite infinite standard measure space, such that the restriction of S to H has no invariant subset of positive finite measure, admits no S-Fellner sequences. And the second claim, if a pair does not have property T, then there is a measure preserving G action on the sigma finite infinite measure space, which has an exhausting S-Fellner sequence and such that S restricted to H is weakly mixing. Well, of course, this second claim is not trivial. This is easy to see. This is easy to prove. And this theorem refines a recent result by Jolissin, paper from archive. So what is the relation of theorem three with Jolissin paper, Jolissin result? To compare, I need one more definition. Let us say that S restricted to H is of weak zero type. S is an action if there is a subsequent HM, which goes to infinity in H such that such a limit equals zero for subset AB of finite measure. Or equivalently, if we pass to Koopman unitary representation, then zero is a limit point of the Koopman representation of our action restricted to H. So if you just consider Koopman representation for H associated with the this action S, then it has a zero as a limit point. Okay. When G goes to infinity. Now replacing the words has no invariant subset of positive finite measure in where is this one? Here in this theorem with stronger is of weak zero type and the weakly mixing in two. Weakly mixing in two here with of weak zero type, we obtain exactly the main result of Jolison paper. And let me say again that this property of weak zero type is purely spectral property, and it has weak dynamical properties. We can't say anything about the section while weakly mixing it's implies, of course, ergodicity and conservativeness. So the result is stronger. Theorem 3 is stronger than this result. And corollary. This is a corollary 4. As I say, whenever we have some result for infinite measure preserving action, we can apply Poisson functor and get some result for Poisson actions. So a pair H contains G in G has property T, if and only if every probability preserving, of course, Poisson G action with weakly mixing H sub action is strongly ergodic. The same is also true if we replace ergodic, if we replace a weakly mixing with ergodic, because for Poisson actions, ergodicity and the weak mixing are the same. Okay. That's all that I wanted to talk today. Thank you for attention.
Thank you for an interesting talk. Are there any questions? So we'll start with a question from the audience and then we'll pass to the online question.
Yes, I just wanted to know, is testing known how the Thompson groups has the Hagerup property or?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not sure. I don't know. Probably you should learn this. Look at this book about Hagerup property.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. So there was a question online. Was there no question? Any questions? Any other questions? So if there are no other questions, let's thank the speaker again. And we're